Hi, I'm Mel Wright. We're here in Chapel Hill today at the School of Government to make a presentation of the 2012 Chief Justice's Professionalism Award to Jim Drennan.
Good day. I'm Franklin Freeman, and I'm here at the UNC School of Government to interview the 2012 recipient of the Chief Justice's Professionalism Award, Professor Jim Drennan, longtime professor here at the School of Government and former the Institute of Government. And want to begin by exploring Jim's early youth and development down in McCormick, South Carolina, where Jim grew up. I'm a great believer that we're molded by our early beginnings. And Jim, tell us about growing up in this county seat town down on the Georgia line.
Well, McCormick County is the smallest county in South Carolina. It has about 7,000 people. It's in many ways, it's like Mayberry without Andy Griffith. It was a very good place to be born and raised. I grew up in a family of loving mother, loving father, and two sisters. I was the last one. I was the baby. I was the only boy. They allege, at least, that I got special treatment. I've never seen adequate proof to believe that, but that's a strongly held belief among my sisters. And so I grew up walking to school when I wanted to, or riding my bike. It was about a mile away. It was a sort of a classic small town environment. And it was the kind of place where pretty much if you did anything, everybody knew about it. So my mother didn't need much supervision because the whole town was available to supervise me if they needed to be. And that was true of all my friends. So it was a very warm and loving place to grow up. We spent a fair amount of time at church. It was a community environment for us. It was a small school. In fact, my high school class had 37 people in it.
Graduates.
There were two schools. There was a elementary school, and then there was one high school. And I lived in a bubble. I lived in a white bubble. I grew up in the middle of the transition brought on by Brown versus Board of Education. It was only much later that I realized the kind of bubble I lived in and sort of the dark side of that bubble, which I've been thinking about a lot as I've grown older. But it was a safe bubble for me to grow up in. As I look back, that safety wasn't extended to everybody, which I think was one of the great moral failings of our society. But McCormick was a good place. It's a poor county. It's mostly red clay and pine trees and a lake on the Georgia border. So, but I personally was nurtured and supported and given wonderful support by my family and by my community, and it was great.
What when you were, particularly as a teenager, what activities were you involved in? What work did you do? Most people in small towns in those days worked, had some sort of job.
They did. My father was a small businessman, and by small, I mean small. He usually had maybe one or two employees for some. He had a lot of different enterprises. The most I remember him having employees was maybe five or six. So when you have a small business, it's the family's business. And that was certainly true in our case. And so I would pinch hit for him through most of my sort of teenage years. His business involved providing food services to the local textile mill. And so that meant it was a very irregular job. There were three shifts. Somebody from my daddy's operation needed to go and check on the machines at every shift. And so I would sometimes do second and third shift duty. It was actually pretty sweet, because there were always leftover candies and pastries and sandwiches and Cokes, and I had the keys to the vending machines, and so it was pretty easy to get whatever I wanted. And so I wouldn't call it hard duty, but that was my job. I did in the summers. I worked for the princely sum of $1.25 an hour for the State Highway Department as a road crew person, cutting down bushes and digging potholes to test soil and stuff like that. But in school, I did the newspaper. I was a little on the nerdy side. If you have a continuum, I was probably past the halfway sign of the nerdy side. But I did play football and basketball until maybe the ninth grade. And then to be the classic nerd, I kept statistics for the group after that as the team manager, and had a great time. My best friends were all in that. I was not graced with great athletic gifts, so I had the judgment to see that by the time I was maybe in the ninth grade.
What were your strengths as far as academics concerned in high school? What were your interests?
What were my interests? I was never interested much in science or math, so I drifted to what we now would call the social sciences and the liberal arts. Mostly history and what I came to realize when I went to Furman, political science and government, current affairs. So it's not surprising, I guess, that I ended up in a place like the School of Government.
You were, McCormick County was adjacent to or near Barnwell County, as I recall. And in your day, Barnwell County had both the Speaker of the House of South Carolina's House of Representatives and the President Pro Tem of the Senate for many years. So basically, Barnwell County, Senator and Representative ran the county, didn't they?
That is correct.
Or state, rather, ran the state.
Pretty much. That Barnwell's maybe 90 minutes from us, but culturally, it wasn't much different from McCormick. It was a pretty small county, and to have those two, and in those days, there wasn't any thought of term limits, and so those two gentlemen stayed on for decades, and they pretty much had a stranglehold on North Carolina government, on South Carolina government, which essentially meant it was rural oriented. It was the big cities of what Greenville, Charleston, Columbia. All their initiatives had to go through Barnwell.
What helped move your interest in government along? What helped develop that?
That's a very good question. I've often wondered why we end up doing what we do, and what role chance plays in that, what role we're sort of destined to do that. I'm not sure I can give you a definitive answer. I tended to enjoy reading about the law, about legal conflicts. I liked the TV shows. I loved Perry Mason. I mean, the world should be like Perry Mason, where everything comes to a clean, definitive, and more or less satisfying conclusion. And I thought, well, if he can do that, maybe I can do that. I don't know. I'll give it a try. But beyond that, I've always had this interest in justice, what it means, from being a really tiny kid, but by the time I was at college, I was, and maybe it's as simple as I see my grandchildren, and they're always interested in getting their fair share. They want to be sure that somebody else doesn't get more than, and I have great grandchildren, so I don't think that's an excessively, I have wonderful grandchildren. In fact, I have perfect grandchildren, but I think it's built into us that we have some yearning to be treated fairly, and justice is ultimately about that. And so I think I didn't know it, but I think I was sort of a justice seeker from pretty early in my life.
That led you from Furman to law school.
It did.
Where?
I came to Duke Law School. One of my really good professors who was very, very good to me was a man named Don Acey, who was a political scientist but also a Duke Law graduate. And he had recently come from the law school, so he knew a lot about it, and he counseled me to apply there, among other places. I applied some other places. It's a sign of the economic world I lived in then, as opposed to the world I live in now, that with something like a $1,500 a year scholarship, Duke would cost me pretty much exactly the same thing as going to the University of South Carolina Law School in the 1970s. And so I did get a scholarship and came to Duke because it was considerably more prestigious, and I wanted to get out of South Carolina. I mean, I didn't go very far, but I did want to at least cross the state lines and see what the world was like. And so it was economically viable and turned out to be a good place for me. So I ended up at Duke in the 1970s, early 1970s.
And from Duke, you came to the what was then the Institute of Government.
Correct, correct.
How did that come about?
And how did that
tell us
happen?
About your earlier years. That's when I got to know you, was
that's
when you
right.
first came here in 74, I believe.
Is I that did. Right? I did. And I think our paths started crossing pretty regularly from then
within
on.
Within the first few days of your
probably,
coming.
That's right. Well, if you're in law school, you look at places to work. And I'd have been a political science major, and so I didn't know a lot about the mission of the Institute of Government, but I had a sort of an intuitive sense that it was something I might be interested in. And I went to an interview, and John Sanders, who is the person for whom the building this interview is being taped in, is named, was the director of the Institute of Government in those days, and he came over, and if you've ever met John, you know he's a very impressive person, and he became, to me, really one of my mentors and one of my role models and one of the people who's really sort of shaped my career. And so he invited me to come to work as a law student, law clerk, after my second year. I decided to split my summer. And so I did, I actually worked here at the Institute for, they had long summers in those days. I ended up working 6 or 7 weeks here and a month in Richmond at a law firm and a month in Charlotte at a law firm, or maybe 3 weeks at a law firm. They were very kind to let me come in for that short period of time, but it gave me a sense of what life was like in the private practice and what life was like here. And I found the work at those law firms, as best I could tell from that limited experience, to be stimulating and challenging, but the subject matter just didn't resonate with me the same way that the subject matter of what was going on here did. So I got offers from some places, but one of them was from here, and it seemed like the right thing to do for me. I didn't know then that I would love teaching, which I do, but I knew that I liked what they were about. I liked what this place was meant to do, which was to make government, however it's defined, and government is constantly being redefined in our world. The role of government will never be settled in this state or in the United States, but it's one thing most people agree on is that we need government. I mean, when we come together as a collective group of people, we have to govern ourselves. And the mission of this place, where I've spent virtually my whole career with a couple of detours, is to make that government work, to make it work for the people who empower the government officials to lead them. And our mission is to help those people. Help those people that are entrusted with the really difficult, challenging work of moving society ahead, helping people live the good life, however they define it. That's the mission of the School of Government. That it's written more elegantly than that, but that's really what it's about. And it was a pull for me. It was a lure for me. It reeled me in emotionally. I like to say when we have people who come here, and we have wonderful people who work here, they need to catch the virus. They need to catch the virus of making government a better institution than it was last year. If they catch that virus, they'll like it here.
Albert Coates would be mighty proud of you. Jim, I think you've just articulated the vision he had for this place when he opened it, or commenced trying to fund it, and did successfully, obviously, in the 30s.
Albert Coates was an amazing person. I came on after he had departed from the Institute. He'd actually fully retired. But I would see him most days walking across from the graveyard over to the law school through our parking lot. He would come by our offices sometimes and drop off books he'd written, and he'd always have an inscription with my name on it, which I always thought was pretty cool, that he'd taken the time to write everybody's name. Yeah, he's one of those people that make the world a different place. They leave the world different than they found it. It's a real gift. He was, by all accounts, a difficult person to work for, a little bit of a rogue, a man of incredible vision. He turned a simple idea into a robust, important institution in this state. And that idea was, he was a law professor. He was teaching local government law. He was teaching criminal law. And he took the initiative to go out and talk to people who actually applied local government law and criminal law. And it became apparent to him pretty quickly that the law he was teaching was not the law they were applying. And he set out to bridge that gap. One of his books was called Bridging the Gap. And that's really what the Institute of Government and now the School of Government is about. It's about making sure that the laws that we write are the laws that we apply, and vice versa, that the people who are in the business of applying the laws can help shape what those laws ought to be, because they're the ones who actually, the rubber meets the road when a city council or a city manager or a county commissioner or a judge or a district attorney has to make a decision that's based on the law.
Let's talk a little bit about the role you have had in fulfilling that vision. As I recall, when you started out in 74, you worked with Ed Hinsdale, who at that time was the person in charge of educating the judges in the state district and Superior Court judges. A new court system had just really been finalized in 1970 with the last of the districts coming under the General Court of Justice. So we had a new infant to nurture and grow. Mm-hmm. And you've been growing it now for 38 years. Mm-hmm. Tell us about working with Ed and how over those 38 years you have seen the system, with the great help of the School of Government, evolve the court system, because most of your work has been training judicial officials.
That's right.
With the two detours we'll talk about in a minute or two.
When I came here, I was in a newly created position that the legislature had created. We'd seen a lot of growth, and I was actually assigned to work in two areas. One of them was to carry Ed Hinsdale's briefcase. The other was to carry Ben Loeb's briefcase. Ben Loeb worked in our area of motor vehicle regulation, and I ended up doing a lot of work specializing in the law related to impaired driving. And so I did spend a fair amount of time doing that. But most of that work involved working with court officials. And so the bulk of my work here has been working with the court system. And you're absolutely right. I was not there at the very beginning, but I was there pretty close to the beginning of the development of the North Carolina court system. And I've had the great privilege of working closely with people who manage that system, people like you when you were the director of the Administrative Office of the Courts and later. Had a great privilege of working with them and seeing how They work hard every day to make justice a reality to the people in the state. We started out with a grand vision of a uniform and unified court system, one where every person, wherever they find themselves, whether it's in the smallest county of the state or downtown Charlotte, which is sort of the most urban center, most urban, most densely populated county in the state probably. We had discovered that we had a system that had evolved to the point where injustices were done solely by the structure of the system. That we had different kinds of courts hearing the same kind of case in different places. We had different kinds of fee structures. We paid some of our court officials based on the results of the decisions they made from the fees that were collected. It was a system that evolved over a century, and it needed retooling, and some very wise and thoughtful people developed the system we have, which values uniformity greatly. The notion, it's a simple notion, the notion that in our justice system, you get the same kind of official with the same powers and duties, the same salary, hearing your case or resolving your case regardless of where you come from. That justice is not dependent on whether you're from a small town or a large city, or whether you're from the east or the west. That's the ideal. As you and I know, we have seen over the years, that ideal is a hard one to achieve. And what I've observed in the operation of the courts over the 30 years is that uniformity is still kind of an animating principle, but there are many, many exceptions to the idea. We have, and we could talk about that a long time, but in general, there seems to always be a tension between the notion of having a central unifying principle to organize the courts and the desire of people in communities to do it differently. And sometimes the desire in the people in the communities prevails. And so they may get special programs that have special fees that no other place pays for. There are a lot of examples of it, but on balance, it's been a marvelous opportunity for me to see just dozens and dozens and dozens of people give their lives, give their professional lives to this idea that justice should be equal and available to everybody. That's a great privilege.
Over those 38 years, it'd have to be hundreds, probably.
Hundreds, yes.
That you have trained and developed.
I've seen generations of judges come and go.
You've seen fathers and sons.
I have seen many times. I've seen, and now both are retired, which tells me something about what I should be doing. When we have, I've seen many, many wonderful people. You're right. It's probably hundreds. It's probably thousands if you count
the
Supreme Court judges, district court judges, clerks of court, prosecutors. My work has touched all those people in some ways. I primarily focus through the core part of my career on judicial education. That's really where. But I've worked with clerks of court a lot, and now I spend most of my time with clerks of court and enjoy it very much. The work they do is really important and often not as appreciated as it should be.
Over the years, beginning in 74 until today, what major changes have you seen in judicial education and in the role of our judicial officials?
Boy, those are two really interesting questions, and they're, let me try to unpack both of those. Judicial education. When I started working in the 70s, judicial education was not even a concept that many states approved of. It was a field that was in its infancy, really. We were a little ahead of the curve having the Institute predated the formation of the court system. And so we were able to provide education to court officials from the very beginning. But there were quite a few states that didn't. Slowly it became the national consensus emerged that judges needed an opportunity to continue their education the same way that physicians do and every other professional group does. When I started, judicial education was primarily one person in front of a room of many people, dozens or hundreds of people, with that one person talking and those other people sitting and listening and taking notes. Lecture was the overwhelming choice of education.
Much like law school.
Much like some of my law school classes, and yours too, I'm sure. One of the great advances in judicial education is the beginning to marry the notion of how people learn, the field of education, with the field of helping judges learn. And some of the best people in this business are not lawyers, they're educators who think hard about how people learn, and then they find other people to come in and actually do the teaching. One of the things that's been really gratifying here is to see the way the Institute's mode of providing education has evolved from lecture being now not the predominant way we teach, but much more interactive work. Because at the end of the day, it's not about what I as a lecturer know. At the end of the day, it's about what the people in the seats learn and what they do with what they learn. And so we focus much more on application of skills. We've been fortunate to get help from the General Assembly to have enough money to have more seminars where people can come in and in smaller groups interact, express themselves, explore their own issues. It's been a really helpful evolution.
You're too modest to mention this, but over the years, the judicial education program here at the School of Government grew to the point that the leadership here at the Institute or the school and the leadership of the General Assembly concurred that there should be a judicial college.
Correct.
Here. And you were the first dean, I suppose, of the judicial
director.
College.
Director.
And
we only
director.
Have one dean, yeah.
And it is, it's basically named for you, as I recall.
No, but it's...
In honor of you.
I don't think that's right. But I was the first director.
And because of you, I think because of the reputation you had with the you let me say this, you don't have to protest because it's true in my view, but because of the reputation you had with the judiciary and the legislature was happy to fund that and to set up the separate judicial college here, and I hope it continues to thrive.
So do I.
I know you do, because it's with the increasing number of judges that we have, the value and need for it only continues to grow.
It's doing really important work. There's a class today of district court judges who are exploring in depth the issues related to, and it's either abuse and neglect or delinquency. I don't know which of those, but that's an example of what the new world of judicial education is about. It's about smaller groups of people focusing in depth on a particular topic, bringing into the conversation not just the legal issues, but the other kinds of issues, the psychologist and the other kinds of professionals who bring to bear on people who understand child development in that context. And that's true across the board, whether we're talking about substance abuse or family law or criminal law. That's been really exciting and gratifying to see. And I'm very, very pleased that I think the Judicial College is funded at a sufficiently good level that we can continue to offer those programs. I think they're really important to help court officials continue to grow. Once you get that job, you've just begun to have challenges. And you've just begun to have the need to learn more. I mean, that's when you need to go into overdrive in the learning mode. It's when you get that job. So that's been really wonderful to see.
Second question.
I would add that I think you helped some in the process as well.
The second part of the question is the role of the judge, how you have seen it evolve. Or the role of the judicial system, perhaps, because it would encompass more than the judges, obviously.
The role of the courts has changed. The courts have evolved from a pretty classic adversarial model, which is still the predominant mode of resolving disputes, to one that has many other facets. Alternative dispute resolution is now a fundamental part of civil litigation and resolution of civil disputes. Then a variety of methods, but that was a change of thinking for the people in the courts. On the criminal side, there's been a pretty significant change in the way many judges think about how to solve particularly troubling, difficult problems, and to pick one, substance abuse. It's a really hard issue in our society. It's very democratic. It cuts across all class lines, all social strata, all communities. Everybody faces that issue in some form. There's been a move to create something called problem-solving courts, where judges' roles are fundamentally different than they are in a regular criminal court. Those judges who engage in that kind of court will see a case come in. They'll make a disposition, but they'll make that disposition in conjunction with a whole range of other people. That's called staffing. And at a staffing meeting, a drug court judge, for example, will preside, but there will be a DA, there will be a public defender, there will be a probation officer, there will be a social worker, there will be a mental health counselor, there will be a sort of a case manager, and they'll all talk about what should happen to this person as they go through their probation period or their period of supervision. And that judge, typically it's one judge, sometimes there are a couple of judges, will see that person over and over again. The person has to come back every 2 weeks or every 3 weeks or every month, depending on the system. And so there's feedback. There's feedback from the participants. There's feedback from the court. Relationships develop. That's not the norm in court adjudication. Normally what courts do is dispose of the case and it's gone. And one of the real downsides for judges is, in that kind of world, the only feedback judges get is negative. If they send somebody out on probation and that person does well on probation, there is not a, let's come back and I want to thank you, judge, for sending me back on probation. There's no positive recognition that something good has happened. But if the person violates, depending on the court, the judge may well see the person again. So it's unfortunate that judges don't, because most of the time, statistics would say, people don't come back. Now, their recidivism rate's not as good as it ought to be, but it's still not over 50%. Judges are deprived of that positive feedback. They get it in drug court. So the people who do that work really like it. Some judges cannot conceive of their role as having that kind of social work component to it. But that's the beauty of working in court administration. It now has multiple faces. There's now not just one version of what it means to be a judge. So it's good. One of our challenges here, of course, is to try to deal with all those judges in wherever they are.
And have the array of courses that will help them.
Yes, correct.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned you took a detour.
I did.
Or two.
I did.
And I know I had a major part in at least the first one.
You had a major part in both of them.
But certainly in the first one, because I was trying to entice you away from here to become the legal counsel, permanent, full-time legal counsel at the Administrative Office of the Courts back in the mid-80s.
Correct.
But ultimately, you came back here.
I did.
Why?
I liked working at the AOC. I liked both. First time you enticed me to work for you. The second time you left the job, and so I was asked to follow you in that job, which was
as the fourth director of the Administrative Office.
Which was not an easy job to follow you, I can tell you. Both times I found it to be, they were different, but both times I found it to be really gratifying because I was surrounded by people who who essentially shared my understanding of what public service is about. Most everybody at the Administrative Office of the Courts when I was there really cared about working to make the courts function better and to help the people who were in the field to do that work. They had good, great technical skills in various ways. There's always a tension between Raleigh and the field, and that was certainly true when I was there. But I think on balance, it was very gratifying. But I came back here because ultimately, I really like teaching. I really like having good conversations with people. And I really like teaching adults. I teach law students some, and I have for the last 15 years. And I like that. I like working with young idealists, people who are about ready to start. But I learn from teaching adults. I never teach a class that I don't come out of the class having learned something from the people in the class. And that's especially true now that we teach in a much more interactive way. And at the end of the day, administration or even practicing law for an agency, while it was very stimulating, I found that my place was in the classroom. It was really where I was most comfortable and most gratified. I got most meaning out of it.
You mentioned your grandchildren a while ago.
Yes.
And that you had perfect grandchildren.
Yes.
I know that you and your wife, Ann Carroll, call her because that's what...
McCormick name.
That's right. That's when I first met
her city name is Ann, but her McCormick name is Ann Carroll.
In 74.
Right.
But you and Ann Carroll have been married how many years now?
We got married in 1972, so 40 years. 40 years. It's been wonderful.
Well, she is a wonderful person. She's
one of my heroes.
I would agree. I would agree with you. You have two children.
I do.
Tell us about your children, your grandchildren.
I have a son who lives in New York who is doing really well. He works in a company that helps nonprofits maximize their fundraising. I can't think of any more noble work than helping people like the American Cancer Society make sure they have the resources to do their job. And that's what Jonathan does. And I think he's very good at it because he's been successful in the company he's with. My daughter, Jennifer, is married and has four children. She lives in Durham, close to our house. She's married to a minister. My son-in-law is the executive minister of a large and growing Baptist church in Durham and Wake County. They have presence in both. I've been blessed. Both my children are really wonderful young adults in their own ways. They've taken different paths through life, as one would expect them to. We wanted them to have roots and then to fly, and they've both flown in different directions, but they both make me proud.
They're fine children. I know both of them and have known them since they were little
mm-hmm,
tykes.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And your four grandchildren, too.
Mm-hmm.
Well, now you are...
So I have an urban son who, you know, and his partner, Mitch.
Yes.
And then I have a suburban daughter. I have one of almost everything with all my two.
Rural mother-in-law living.
She's from a town called Plum Branch, yeah. South Carolina.
Which was a suburb of McCormick.
It was, 5 miles away, yes. I've had a wonderful, rich life.
Jim, you alluded a moment ago to growing up in basically what was a segregated society.
It was.
As practically all of us of my and your age did in the South in the 50s and early 60s. What impact did that and has that experience had on you?
It's been a ever-present and profound impact on who I think I am. And I was dense. I didn't get it when I was there. The world to me was completely normal and natural. when I was a teenager, they closed the only public swimming pool in my town rather than let black kids swim in the water. I didn't blink an eye that that was wrong. So I've come to realize, as we all have as a society, that that kind of segregation was morally wrong. I've found heroes in strange places doing this. When I was in high school, we were not early adapters to Brown versus Board of Education in the town I grew up in. Because I was a high school senior in 1967, and Brown versus Board of Education was handed down in 1954. The first black students in my high school joined my senior class in 1967. So for 12 years, there had been no black kids in my high school at all. We had two young women who joined our class for the senior year. I regret very much not reaching out to them. I should have. To my wife's credit, she did. We were classmates, but I didn't. But the grace with which those two students lived that year, as I look back on it, really has inspired me. We recently seen one of them. One of them has passed away, but the other one, her name is Julia, which is the same as my sister's name, came to one of our reunions, and she's still incredibly gracious. It's inspired me. I think thinking about those issues, thinking about fairness, really, thinking about what and how now, it's a much more complicated world now, I think. It was simple and wrong then. There still are, I think, many examples where we're not as fair and inclusive as we need to be in a variety of settings involving people's civil rights. I think that's part of the reason I've been so interested in fairness. And so one of the things I teach here now for some of our judges and clerks is this notion of fairness, because I think it is a core value of the court system. If there is a more fundamental value than fairness in a court system, I really don't know what it is. And so I think that's the beginning of talking about what a court system should do, is how are you fair? How can you make fairness an everyday occurrence? We have a lot to do in that area. The perceptions of people who are not white about our court system are different from the perceptions of people who are white. Without saying who's right and who's wrong, that's an issue. That's a problem. That's something we need to continue to focus on and try to sort through and figure out. Minorities are vastly overrepresented in things that are not helpful, like prisons and juvenile court involvement. And so there are major efforts across the country to figure out why that is and to sort it out and to try to deal with it and make sure we're fair in the way we deal with each case. And we should continue to do that. It's a journey we may never end, but we need to continue to move down the road. And certainly where I grew up has shaped the way I view those issues. That's the lens through which I view them. As I say, it was a wonderful place to grow up, but it was a bubble.
Well, you are winding up your career mm-hmm. here at the School of Government. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about that. What you are finishing up with, and then what you intend to do after that with your family, with those grandchildren and your children and Anne Carol.
I'm in a program called Phased Retirement. I'm in the middle of a 3-year program. I'm working primarily now with clerks of court and doing teaching on a variety of isolated topics. I've begun to focus some on things like ethics and fairness and judicial philosophy. So I teach segments of our courses for judges on those topics. It's good. I'm enjoying having some time to waste, basically. I can't say I've been productive, but I've enjoyed not being productive. After that, I don't know what comes next. I've probably got a year to sort that out and figure it'll take care of itself. Things I always have along the way, so I have faith this one will too.
Speaking of faith, I know you're very active in your church, you and Ann mm-hmm. Carol both, mm-hmm. and you are a person mm-hmm. of great mm-hmm. faith. Mm-hmm. And you've been very active in the community in Durham,
mm-hmm.
In working.
My wife is much more a pillar of the community than I am, but yes, I've done some work there. My church is very important to me. I go to a church called Watt Street Baptist Church. We've been there over about 40 years. We spend a lot of time there. We spend a lot of time there. And I can't imagine my world without it, frankly. It sort of shapes how I view the world and what I expect from me and from my Creator, and importantly, how I should deal with the people I'm come in contact with. It's become increasingly clear to me that we're expected to make the kingdom come on earth, and not just in heaven. And so that doesn't happen automatically. We're all God's children, but we're all God's hands too. So
that may be a fitting conclusion to this interview, because you have just encapsulated for all of us, I think, why you have received the Chief Justice's Professionalism Award. And that's because you are not only a model professor, a model teacher, a model administrator, but you are a model person. Jim, congratulations.
You're very kind. Thank you.